Amen. Well, Michigan, we got our ice, we got our snow. Back again, normal. Amen. So, a lot of sicknesses going around. Continue to pray for people. With that, pray for our country. I'd like to preach this morning from a text found in 1 Chronicles 29 and verse 14. 1 Chronicles 29 and 14. It won't be the only scripture, naturally, but it's where we're going to start. It's the idea and the thought that I got from it. The title of the message is, But Who Am I? But Who Am I? 1 Chronicles 29:14. And I'm going to pray. Father, we need your help. We need your guidance. We need the Holy Ghost. Father, we pray that you give me clarity of thought, liberty of speech, that should be with the hearers, that they be prepared to hear your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Now this is David, and it's getting towards his end time, and as you know, he had a burden to make a house for the Lord, and he'd never be able to enter it because he had bloody hands, God told him. But he did, he was able to supply all the needs for the house. And this is where we're at right here. But who am I? In 1 Chronicles 29:14, David says, But who am I? And what is my people that we should be able to offer so willingly after this sort? For all things come of thee, and of thine own have we given thee. Now John Gill, he's an expository of scripture, probably a Calvinist, but he's got some good ideas, and he sort of expounds on this verse right here and separates it a little bit. He says, But who am I? Originally, dust and ashes, a sinful creature, unworthy to receive anything from God, and of having the honor of doing anything for him. And if you think about that he's exactly right. Just as David was crying out, Who am I? But who am I? I mean, if you think about it, I was trying to think who coined the phrase. I remember Rex Harrison saying we're animated dust balls one time, and I don't know if he coined it or if he got it from somebody else, but that's about it. We come from dust. I mean, God breathed that soul, that living air in us. I mean, life came from God. And then later on, we've been born again, if you're saved here today, been saved by the mercy and grace of God. And you had to know what you were before you got saved. You see, he found you. You didn't find him. And when grace found you, where were you? If you thought you could do anything to get to heaven, you're not going to heaven. So you had to know who you were. So this, thinking about dust and ashes and sinful creatures that we are and unworthy to receive anything from God, it's just amazing. And then the other part of the verse, and what is my people? And this subject, to him, the least of all people, talking about the nation of Israel. They were separated from the nations round about them, and the nations despised them. Talking about David now. And this is what he was thinking. And then also that we should be able to offer so willingly after this sort. That they, who were a poor people some years ago, if you remember, brought out of Egyptian bondage, should now be possessed of such an influence or affluence and have such a generous heart and liberal spirit given them as to contribute in so large and liberal a manner as they had done, all was owing to the goodness of God to them and the efficacy of his grace upon them. If you remember where they came out of, they had nothing. They were slaves, they were servants, they were captives, and they were there for their own doing also. But God got them out. God raised them up. And then, for all things come of thee. And Gil says, all good things, temporal and spiritual, the Lord is the fountain of goodness and the Father of mercies. And then to close the verse, and of thine own have we given thee. And for there is nothing a man has, but he has received from the Lord, and therefore can give nothing to him but his own. And so the whole gist, the whole thought is, but who am I? Considering ourselves with our things, considering ourselves in a relationship with God. David said, but who am I? And when compared to the knowledge he had of God, When you and I understand the finite substance we have obtained by knowledge of the infinite God, we must conclude that nothing gets by him and nothing that he wants can refuse him, yet he allows us to participate. So David's knowledge of God, our knowledge of God as Christians, we need to understand those things. Now the Apostle Paul writes in Romans 11:33, go to Romans 11, and I'll not read everything for you, even though I printed it out, but go to Romans chapter 11, and we'll start about verse 33. The Apostle Paul writing to the Romans there. But who am I? And in Romans 11:33 it says, oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. These people that are trying to say they know about God and they know all the stuff that God's thinking and all this stuff, that's a bunch of garbage. If they could think like God all the time and think what he's thinking, they'd be God. It's just crazy stuff going on in the world today in the name of religion. And anyway, verse 34, for who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been his counselor? Every time I read that, I just laugh. You imagine putting God on a couch and counseling him? I mean, our day and age is really stupid. I mean, really. And then verse 35, or who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again. And then look at verse 36, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. What does that mean? Exactly what it says. It concurs with what David said. But who am I? Remember, David gathered all the goods together. So to know about God, you must read about him. And all you can grasp, really, is the carnal interpretation of him. He is all-powerful and all-knowing and everywhere, according to the Old and New Testaments, as we read by an unsaved person, that's all he can get out of there, like reading a literature book. And because he's unsaved, apparently he hasn't believed it, but what he'll say is this book claims that their God is everywhere, knows everything, right, and is all-powerful. That's what their book claims, as I read it. And then they'll go into all the other things that they say the book claims through their perception and interpretation, like they've been doing for years, to try to add skepticism, add doubt to anybody that would believe the book. But that's what they would surely come up with, if being lost. But a saved person understands this mentally, but knows it intuitively by the God Spirit. When I read the book, there's a blessing, there's a connection between my spirit and that book. I've got no skepticism when it comes to that book or the God that I serve. He is. He really is. And as Christians, we have obligations to our Lord, and pleasing him is our priority. Serving our Lord by faith is his plan for our age. Without faith, it is impossible to please him, and whatsoever is not of faith is sin. That's what God said, and I believe it, and that's just it. And like the good preacher says, whether you believe it or not, if God said it, it's it. He doesn't revolve around us. So walking by faith is a journey with no resources but God's, no confidence in the flesh, and anticipating God's action on our behalf of what he has said. Walking by faith is a journey with no resources but God's, no confidence in the flesh, and anticipating God's action on our behalf of what he has said. Think about where you are. Think about what you do. That's why I always bring up work and standards of work and because they always get down on Christians, that believe in some kind of form of standards. And yet they go to work and they do exactly what their boss tells them. They go to work on time, punch in, have a responsibility, and they do it. But then they play God like a second fiddle or something. Like second rate. He gets the leftovers. And you wonder why the journey's messed up? Because you put more into your job, your work, your future than you do God. To get that attitude, but who am I? That's humility. That's understanding you. My goodness, God's everything. And the problem with a lot of people is God takes you from when you were down to when you're up. And then you stay up and you forget about when you was down until you get down again. If we could only get this attitude as David had, it would be just a miracle thing. So as we give our tithes, offerings, and time, if we're not careful, we will forget what David said, but who am I? David's desire was to build a house that God could reside in, and God allowed him to build it. As king, he controlled wealth and had allies who would help him. He collected all that was needed, but understood God's provision included all that he had or could get to perform his work for God. He knew that everything that he was getting and everything that he had was provided by God. He didn't say, I'm king and I got it anyway. He didn't say, I worked and I got it anyway. He said, it's God's. See, the work of God has been stopped in many areas of our country because of Christians not knowing what David knew. They keep that which God requires, and what happens? Requires for what? For running his business. They think it belongs to them. Why? Because they work for it. I mean, his church is closing, missionaries suffer, all because Christians don't believe God and are not interested in knowing him. I mean, can you or I imagine that we know better than God? When people just parrot stuff, it's just amazing, you know? All you guys want is money. You know, we joke, yeah, that's right. And then they take it serious, and so I told you. Where'd you get your money? See, first ask me, General Motors. Oh, why'd they give it to you? Because I worked hard for it. Oh, then you're like a steward, right, of your own money. Yeah. Oh. Who do you belong to? What do you mean, who do I belong to? Well, my wife, my kids. Are you saved? Yeah. Who do you belong to? Oh, God? Oh, you mean God? You belong to God. Oh. Did God give you a manual? Yes. Have you read your manual? Why is it you don't take his manual serious? It's not about how much or this and that. It's about the motive. It's about your heart. It's about, my goodness, man, where were you at before he found you? Who gave you breath? Who gave you health to work? Who even reared up these companies to take care of us? It's going to go back to God. It's not the devil. It's God. God allowed this stuff and put us in the midst of it and takes care of us. Faith is, it's a whole lot of stuff that we need to consider. I thought about that. Can you or I imagine that we know better than God? Can we actually think what we have is ours? As Christians. I mean, when he saved us, what part of, quote, we were bought with a price, you don't understand? See, once again, you get into word for word study of the Bible, or you get into your emotional thinking, or what you think God is. Oh, yeah, that's right, that's got to be God. And you neglect the word of God. Some things are just foundational. They're just right there. And because you know them and you practice them, then that intuitiveness, that emotional feeling, everything is you're like this with God. But when you separate that, you run your way on emotions. Well, I just feel this and this is just wrong. And you gather around other people that are talking about emotional stuff. And yeah, that's wrong. Yeah, but this and that. And you go on and on and on and on. Nobody says, but what does God say? What does God say? Everybody's got a better way than God. It don't work. God gave us a great commission. He didn't stutter. So how are you going to get the gospel to the world? Huh? You got a better way? How are you going to support for your churches? You got better ways? Who's going to pay for electricity and gas? Who's taking care of all that? Oh, somebody else will? No, they won't. They won't. God designed it where everybody does their part. They're a family, and that's called the family of God. And when people don't like that, and they get messed up over that, and they leave, the church suffers, they suffer. That's how God designed things. First Corinthians, you don't have to turn there, but 1 Corinthians 2:16 says, "For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." What does that mean, preacher? Well, number one, we don't instruct God. And number two, but we should have his understanding by the Holy Spirit of God on what our living for him includes. He didn't leave us in no fog. He told us exactly what that includes. Your body and your spirit is his, according to my Bible. So boasting's not good. It communicates the pride of the individual and all that he has accomplished. We must always remember all that we have or do comes from God. 1 Corinthians 4:7 says, "For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive?" Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it? That's in the Bible? Yeah, that's in the Bible. In 1 Corinthians there, and 4:7. "For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive?" That's the key. "Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hadst not received it?" What does that mean? Well, I think it means like you didn't receive it. Or could it also mean that you got it on your own power? Nobody gave it to you? And when it's talking about receive it, receive what from whom? He says everybody's in the same boat. What you got from God. So you glory in God, you don't glory in yourself. You don't boast in yourself. You don't boast in your works. Do you understand? You praise God, thank God. I don't care if your hair lips the devil and everybody hanging around you that's trying to pump you up and inflate you. You tell them, "I thank God for the opportunity to do that. I thank God for the power to do that. Thank God for the talent to do that. It ain't about identity. My identity is in Jesus Christ, period." Amen. He gives. He takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You don't want to get money? He'll take your money. You'll find out who gives you the money. You don't want to give time? You don't want to pass out? I'm telling you. Our Father knows how to get us in a place. And he does it because he loves us. Yes, he does. I mean, think about it. God has allowed us to be in his family. He has given us purpose. I mean, here in time and in eternity, we have a purpose. I mean, when we go to be with the Lord, we got a purpose. We got a purpose now. That's sort of neat. We don't know when we're going to die. Do you? Let me know if you know. I mean, we'll make preparations and get the date and get the funeral ready and everything. I mean, if you know. I mean, think about it. It's sort of spooky. I mean, Psalms 100 and verse 3 says, "Know ye that the Lord, he is God, and it is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves." We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Oh, that's Jewish. Oh, man, that's scripture. That's principle. Mm-hmm. That's practical.
Yeah.
I mean, that's so doctrinal, pathetic. I mean, made us. Who made you? 2 Corinthians 3:5 says, "Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God." What do you do with verses like this? Sufficiency. That means you're going to make it. Why? Because of God. Not because of you, because of God. Well, that means I can just sit home and everything happens. No, you're being stupid now. You got health, you work, you got a mind, you're thinking. But you know these things our glory to you, God. The Bible goes on and it's just replete with verses on this subject. But in 2 Corinthians 4:5 it says, "For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus Christ." And in 2 Corinthians 10:12, the Bible says, "For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise," Paul says. "You're foolish." See, David had some things right, that's for sure. David definitely had some things right. And the things he had right about God, God approved of and blessed. Those things in Scripture that record actions and beliefs that please God, I mean, they should be things we want to believe and practice. I mean, if you want to know what pleases God, if you feel a little doubting of your security or anything, I mean, it'd do you well to read the Bible, wouldn't it? See what God's happy about. What pleases God? I mean, it's pretty simple. Read what pleases God. And then apply it. That'd be a real good thing. Help David. Help many souls on the way. Every time you get on social network or something, read like Terry Tinboon or you see yourself, you ought to really read what they've put in their journals, what they've come to the conclusion with, and how it can help you. These are people that read the Bible, that believed what the Bible said, and just lived in that Bible. They didn't care about what was being politically correct or what was being preached or even taught in their generation. They served God. They served God. But who am I? Who do you think you are? You're so independent. You're independent of God. That would be a scary statement, wouldn't it? You're so independent that you're independent of God. I remember years ago, we prided ourselves by being independent fundamental Baptist. Independent fundamental. Supposed to meant that everybody was indigenous, they had their own local churches, and you know. But it almost got to be where, you know, if it wasn't my way, it's the highway. And started getting away from God and started focusing on other things. And we can do that just as individuals. We can get our focus off of God and onto us. And before we know it, we're independent of God. We are independent of God, and yet we think we're so tight with Him. But we're actually independent of God. And that's scary. You are going to do it your way, and no matter what anybody says. I know everyone's had that experience in themselves, thinking that way, and hearing other people say that, and then they go off into destruction because they won't let anybody tell them what to do. I heard somebody say, "Preacher, I'm just a sinner saved by grace." Well, no, you are a Christian because of grace, with the power of the Holy Spirit to give you victory over sin. That's what you are. Didn't we always claim that? "I'm just a sinner saved by grace." They got a song like that. And everybody says, "Okay, I just keep sinning because I'm just a sinner saved by grace." No, that's not supposed to be an excuse. Everything is focus. Everything is motive. Our motive of life needs to be in line with Scripture, not the world. All our work will be judged by what sort it is. That's a fact. That's a fact. That's all of us. What we receive, whether good or bad, must come through our Father's approval. What we do with what we have shows what we believe. What we have that has been freely given to us from God can easily be taken away by God. But who am I? I mean, let us all consider our own thinking on God's plan and how He uses us in it. I mean, our time, our money, or His time and His money. That's the key. So we got a smaller church now. God separated Tony and his family from us in a good way. A good way. He's doing a fine job up there. He's going to do, I'm telling you, very well. And what a blessing that should be to us that God would do that. and how he left and how he's doing and all this stuff. Just perfect. Perfect will of God. So knowing that, and knowing that we know about prayer, and knowing we know about the King James Bible, and knowing all the stuff we know, we got to be doing. We got to be doing. What is that? I'm telling you, if we got tracts, pass them out. I'm not going to twist your arm, but good night. Why wouldn't you want to give somebody a gospel tract? They're going to hell. We know that. We got the book, right? We may not be able to get out there and do what we're supposed to be doing for ours door to door, but bless God, you can be a Christian 24/7. And you can go to your prayer closet and have a list in there and say, God, build our church. Help me lead somebody, Lord. Help me get somebody to church. You know, help me be what you want me to be. You could have a steady prayer closet like that. See, there's too many people running around that know all this and are not practicing what you believe. You get an opportunity to tell something about the Lord, what do? You do it. You don't like something about Victory Baptist Church, what do? You complain about it. No, pray about it. You seriously pray about stuff. I mean, you ought to know there's certain things that are happening, you know, financially and other things around here. I mean, it doesn't come out. God's got to intervene with certain things. But we have to do our part. But who am I? You need to really consider that today. Who am I? Would I be closer to God if I was in the hospital today? You know, really. Would I be closer to God if everything fell out? I lost my job, no way to pay anything. Maybe you got a wife, kids, maybe just yourself. Maybe you know, who knows? Maybe loved one passed away. Maybe you're around all these hell-bound sinners and you haven't said anything. Maybe, I'm telling you, God. See, this thing is for us. Do you understand that? We are going through certain things to please God while we're down here. God's in charge. And we need to surrender to what we already know to do. And then God will in turn answer, just as he always has. He blessed David. And I believe he blessed David because of David's heart. We already know David could repent in a second. And it wasn't a fake repentance. He got with it, man. When it was clear to him. He just repented and said, oh God, I'm sorry. And here we know that he's got all these resources. He could do everything and not even give God credit. But he had sense enough to know that it was God that provided all that stuff. That he was giving back to God. Who would have thought? It's God's system. Why? Because God's got to get all the glory. It's pretty simple practice. So let's all stand. Amen. Well, you know how your week's been going. You know how the fantasy land's been going. You know, I always mention that fantasy land because we get stuck in that head too long. Amen. Get on, you know, whatever it is you watch or do or whatever. You got to prepare yourself in the morning like I taught you earlier in Sunday school about prayer. Prayer is very important. Very important. All day long. You need it, I need it. Church needs it. People in our church need it. For you not to do that, one day you're going to be in a position where you're going to have an operation, something's going to happen. You know what you're going to do? You're going to say, preacher, please pray. Oh, get the church to pray for me. And you're going to be serious of a heart attack because it may be a heart attack. And you're going to, right then and there, it's going to cross your mind that you've never prayed for anybody else in the church. That'd be disgusting. I need to go before God and have God put his finger on my heart and say, well, why don't you start praying for other people? It's very serious business. Prayer is serious business. Prayer is communicating between you and your Father. And it's good for you because you need to know his presence. It'll clean your head up. It'll get that dirty heart clean. It'll keep you from watching certain things and listening to certain chaos and gossip and junk. It's just what God wants for his children. Think about where you are today. Think about where you need to be. And just ask God to come in and control your life, your family, just your mind, your thoughts. And bring that up to him every day. And let's see some God work in our church in a unique way. You don't have to follow anybody else's rules. We just want God to work in our church in a wonderful way. Father, we love you, and we thank you for your mercy and grace. And once again, we bring up those folks that are sick, that you allow them to get better quick. We also pray, dear God, for Ed and his back as he's working. We pray for Brother Suvers. He had to leave to drive his son to the airport. We pray that you give him traveling mercies and that he not get lost and coming back. And Father, that you just be with him, give him peace, give him comfort. Father, we pray that once again you be with Richard and Mrs. Shore, with just their mind and their thoughts. And God, just fill them with good things. And be with Louise as she's with her sister, 75-year-old sister. Father, dear God, that you continue to bless her and watch over her. Be with our youngins in the church, Father, that they grow up wanting to know about you. And God, that you'd save them at an early age. And our teenagers, we pray, Father, that even as much as they want to be adults, think like adults, Father. We pray, dear God, that you just give them the wisdom that they need to survive in this climate of technology and spirits that we're in today. Pray that you just bless us today now. We'll give you all the praise and honor. Praise you give us back at 5, those that are coming. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.